Sir, you mentioned a lot of points. Just some questions, Sir, obviously yesterday, sir, we heard the deliberation that the Ministry of Power was having, and at one point it is fair that they want to instill some discipline in the DISCOMs, wherein they are saying, wherein a proposal was made that DISCOMs which do not have a proper track record of reducing the AT&C losses, etc., banks should be more careful, especially public sector banks should be more careful lending to them. Unfortunately, whenever these kind of stringent actions are happen, unfortunately, the first people to suffer are the renewable energy developers. Because the DISCOM say that, a coal guy must be paid his dues because he has to pay a fuel bill, but, wind and solar guys or the renewable energy guys, their bill gets to tend to be delayed first because they feel, they can still operate without any ESOP. How, sir, you mentioned about incentivizing a DISCOM for example, rooftop. Can a method be thought out where a DISCOM is incentivized that all the PPAs, renewable energy PPAs that they have signed in the past, some of them are high cost, that they should honor them, they should keep paying? Because, sir, you would realize that this security is the key to reducing the sector risk and therefore also reducing the cost of capital down and bringing the tariff even further down.
I must say about this regarding that high cost PPAs, yes. One example is in Gujarat was the first state who led the solar mission in the initial stage, and still they are having a PPAs for 12 rupees per unit, and they are still paying for it. So now it is happening. We have heard in some cases where the DISCOM say now the price has come down and will not honor it. So the issue by all the developers have been brought to our ministry, to the minister itself, and he is coming out with a direction in this, that the PPAs entered have to be honored. So let's see. Obviously, if you see 2 years back, what in solar you don't have any recurring expenditure except some cleaning and all that. So what the main cost is the capital cost. If 2 years back the capital cost was two times and it is half today, obviously the tariff has also come half and he has already invested that much money. You can't compare it with that. So this thing already it is in the thinking. And let's hope something is in the offing.
Absolutely, sir. I think it's very important, that the DISCOMs are today, for example, you mentioned the good example of Gujarat. And I think the investors also reward good states. I think if you have a state tender, Gujarat tends to attract a much, much better lower bid than any other, any of the other states. So, I think our DISCOMs need to be shown that today we are only still reached 20 gigawatts of solar, right? So we have 80 gigawatts still to go. So you will reap benefits of payment discipline in terms of further risk reduction and tariff reduction in the future. But just wondering, I think the MNRE has done a good job. We know that you had called a meeting of all the states also to, ensure that these are, but maybe again, if some kind of a financial incentive can also be given for timely payment, I think that will just, ensure that apart from the, spirit, there is economic incentive for them to do so. So the other concern is obviously now you have laid out a full year-on-year tenders kind of thing for the, going up to 100 gigawatts. But then now there have been some murmurs regarding where is the demand for this power. Unfortunately, the CEA statistics, and there are debates about the methodology which is used, somehow show that India is already, kind of power surplus. So that's another, especially when international investors look to enter into a country and, look to invest for the long term. These are some of the concerns which are coming, that if so much of tenders are coming in, will you start seeing some, some people, some grid backdowns? Is there so much of, demand as a, is there some, what are your thoughts on that and how can that be addressed? Obviously, we are still 1/4 the per capita electricity consumption of even the BRIC nation. So I'm sure we have a long way to go.
You're right in saying so, that as of now, whatever capacity for power generation is there, our demand is less than that. So we are power surplus as of now. So when we are adding so much of power, obviously, your concern is genuine, but let me tell you, this issue was more troublesome when the tariff of solar energy was high. Now, with the tariff coming down to as low as 2.44 in some states and other states also within rupees 3, this issue is no more troubling, because Now, he can, if power is available, like I tell you, the NTPC, that National Thermal Power Corporation, who is the biggest supplier of thermal power, they have, they are also setting up the solar plants. And now they, when the solar power was costlier than the thermal power, that time they were asked to set up the solar power plant and bundle the solar energy with them and then decide the price and give it. Now they said now the reverse should also be there. I am generating, I have to give so much of power to the state. Whether I generate from thermal plant or solar, I have to give you so much and my PPA should be this. So bundling of solar power with the thermal or any other power is in the consideration. Once it is done, then suppose in the daytime you get a more solar power, you can reduce the production of power at that time from thermal and reduce your consumption in that. The coal or oil or gas, whatever you are doing. So that should happen. This has to happen. And number two is the scheme. Now we are thinking very seriously how to make it mandatory that the surplus power in the daytime is stored, not only in battery. Battery is a very costly proposition, is it? The storage in the through pumping in the hydro dams is now being talked about in a serious manner. Yeah, so we are going to store it and in the night when you need again, you take it from hydro and all that. So this third thing is when you are going to reach each and every village, every house, when electrification is going, development is coming, industry is coming, it is expected the overall energy demand will increase. And if demand, there is a gap between them, then it will be compensated. Solar energy, because of its cost, effectiveness, it is bound to be received. Let me, because it is related solar, let me share with you the recent tender in the wind power. Nobody expected the rates, six bidders, rates varying between 2.44 rupees to 2.45 rupees. These are the rates of the wind power. And one more thing I just forgot to share with you is now we are coming out with a solar, wind and battery hybrid power, which will give you 24/7 power. And first offer has come from a concern who is offering the 24/7 renewable power at less than 4 rupees. I don't expect. And with the battery's price coming down, we can expect another 1.5 year, it may touch the level of 3 rupees. And if your renewable powers, 24/7 firm powers is available at 3 rupees, you tell me, everyone will buy it, every DISCOM, everyone, every power supplier will buy it and they will reduce the production from their thermal. A new thermal power plant of NTPC, the power rate as of now is varying from rupees 340 to 390. Even somewhere it is 420, 440. And if you get 24/7 power from solar, wind and combined together at around 350, who will not take it? So, besides the cost effectiveness, the other advantages of the pollution, environment, sustainability, they get give a predominance to this sector in the times to come. That's why the world over people are talking about it.
No, sir, I think so, yes. I think so, the, you know, and this is one aspect that India can be very proud that the entire concept of having reverse auctions to drive down, to increase competition and drive down, this is something which the West has now followed from us. So Europe has now started doing reverse auction, and you know they for the first time introduced reverse auction for their offshore wind, and they saw prices fall by 70%. So that's something that they have actually learned from us. You know, typically we look to the West. I think that's been a very, very kind of a, you know, healthy.
One more thing I must tell you that because of the land, the issue we said, now we are coming up with a floating solar in all the hydro dams. Already survey is being done and we are coming up very soon with the tenders where we'll go for that. And offshore wind. In one or two countries, offshore wind, they say the efficiency of the power generation is almost 1.5 times than the onshore wind, and the extra cost for installation is covered, and they are getting at par prices for the offshore wind electricity generation. And we are going to set up now, we are going to invite the tenders for the offshore wind also. So these are the things, how the concerns are being addressed gradually as and when the problems are coming.
Right. Just one more question and then we'll open it to the audience. So just last thing, obviously you mentioned about this great the Prime Minister Modi's vision that where, you know, one of the ways to doubling farmers' income could also be that they actually sell back the solar pump power to the grid. I think so it's a fantastic, I think it's a win-win for all, you know, there is no, so I guess the first step in this would be that you need to, MNRE now needs to possibly call a meeting of the Forum of Indian Regulators and ask everybody to specify a feed-in price for the farmer to kind of pump back the storage, right? So any thoughts on how will this be rolled out and what are the timelines for it? Because this really has a potential to reform not just the agri, you know, on the farmer side, but also on the distribution DISCOM health side, because that is the biggest drain right now with the DISCOM has.
Your point is well taken that I think we'll require a consultation with the state government about the feed-in tariff for such a scheme. We are just formulating the scheme as of now. We are working out how to do it, and already we are approaching a cabinet very shortly with this. But this, once the scheme is approved, this stage will come at that stage. Your point is noted and well taken that we'll have a consultation with all the state governments to decide what should be the feed-in tariff. Because there is no point in our fixing a feed-in tariff which is not viable or acceptable to the state government. We will do it. Our minister, last time we had one meeting with all the state governments, we'll plan for it. And also for other schemes which are in the offing. Possibly, they will also be through the state governments and other things. So it is always better that the field level, state level officials and their field level officials who are involved in this, they are involved in the decision making.
Unfortunately, sir is running late for it. So we'll just basically take maybe two questions, make it a short question, and you know, direct it to.
Government kya hoga aur government support karega? Kyunki sir, sabse zyada dikkat land mein yehi aata hai ki we stuck up in acquisition of land. We stuck up as a developer. If you go and purchase the land or lease the land, we stuck up with certain statutory issues on local level and state level. So how the government is coming with a set of policy framework to sort that out?
I think when as a developer, as of now, you go for setting up a solar plant, you are buying the land. And there is a change of land use for which you get stuck up. Here it is, you are not going to buy the land. The developer himself will set up a plant, farmer itself, or he will engage somebody, you on my behalf, you do it. Or third is, he will give it on lease. If it is giving on lease, is it required? A change of land use is required in that case? I don't think so. I don't know. Mr. Manu can tell. But if he is not selling the land, if you are not doing it, does it still require? I'm not very sure. Okay. And if there are any such issues, we'll definitely address those issues. Though all such issues, your point, we take note of it. When we have a consultations with the state governments, and we decide the guidelines and how to implement it, that time we can take this point also into consideration.
The guidelines would be straight enough to go to state level.
Yeah, so that please rest assured, the guidelines, detailed guidelines will be there. Let me mention with you, even if, I tell you, the solar parks or big plants which are coming up, we have issued a standard bidding guidelines for that in August 2017, and now a lot of over a last period of 6 months, we realized a lot of problems people are experiencing. Some representatives have come and now we are considering to address and bring out a change in that. So even if it is a continuous process, and there is a very good system here that everything, continuous interaction is there with the people, all the stakeholders, and the problems experience are being addressed. So if you expect in the first go itself, each and every problem will be resolved, nobody will face any problem. Possibly that may not happen. We can't visualize everything.
The Ministry of Power expects that every household would be given the electricity. In fact, what you have already spoken about, the Andaman Nicobar and Lakshadweep, where the solar can be the best option. In fact, today's morning newspaper says that the UT of Diu already has got 100% solar electricity. So in that context, when we are talking about the remote areas where the cost of supplying power from the conventional source itself would be high, so a mini grids or local grids could be a better option. But right now the issue in front is, if there are some developers or somebody plans to set up a mini grid to supply to that particular area, local area, remote area, And under the Sabhagya scheme, if government electrifies it, what happens to that mini-grid?
Let me tell you, there was a scheme for mini-grid. We have slowed down or rather not pursuing it further, primarily because of this reason. That once the Sabhagya scheme has come, everything is electrified, the concept of micro-grid does not find any way. But in the new scheme for the farmers, where we say ki farmers can form a cooperative or a developer, and there they are permitted to generate the power up to 2 megawatt. That is what the thinking is, and then there a small mini grid will be there where a developer can form a mini grid and he may supply it to the grid surplus power, or he can also distribute there only. It is a some sort, not called a mini grid, but it will be some sort of form of mini grid also. Because suppose there are 100 farmers who pool their land and they tell somebody, you set up the system for us. So they have to be connected. The power have to be equated. It will be, though we are not going for a mini grid, but some form of mini grid will come in this, where the power will be developed, aggregated, and utilized by the people, and surplus will be sent to the grid. But with the Sabhagya scheme, mini grid scheme which was already there, that we have stopped now. Because it was basically planned in those areas where electricity supply was not there. You set up a solar plant, small solar plant, and make a mini grid, and somebody is having a surplus, somebody having not, somebody is not using it, and one person who has aggregate all this and he will keep account of all this. That is what the macro grid was. But with electricity reaching every village, every house, this particular concept no longer remains valid. As of that, again, it is how does it evolve in the times to come, I can't comment right now, but this is how it is planned to bring out.
I think, sir, we'll not keep you late because obviously, you know, the matter of the country. One or two more questions? Great.
Hello.
Yeah.
You talked about the rooftop. So my question is related to the one policy conflict, related to the net metering. So some state renewable agency says net metering you can go ahead up to 10 megawatt, and when we go to DISCOM, DISCOM says our policy document says only 1 megawatt. So these kinds of conflicts is really a stopping rooftop to grow up.
Let me answer you, as of now, the CERC, Central Electricity Regulatory Commission instructions are only for net metering permitted up to 1 megawatt only. And some of the states governments have said to permitted up to 10 megawatt, but their state regulators have not issued it. So unless the state regulator commission issues it, it doesn't find acceptability to the DISCOMs. So if there is a request, either it should first, I remember one of the state governments referring the issue to CERC. So as of now, up to 1 megawatt net metering is permitted by CERC. So this has to be either increased by CERC, and reference has to come from various state governments or regulators or the people. You people find any such request coming to us, we'll approach CERC.
Right.
Because CERC has to first, I know state regulator commissions are saying ki if CERC issues these instructions, we have no problem in doing it. So the problem is that, not exactly what it is. So the solution to this problem is that CERC has to issue the directions. Possibly in the new policy, we'll try to address this.
And I think, sir, the other thing is very clearly, I think so there are, you know, DISCOM, you know, there is a conflict with the DISCOM in this game. Obviously, the DISCOM does not want to let go of its customers. Even the DISCOM is procuring green power at 2.5 rupees. I think it's very important that, you know, rather than citing regulation, then bottling a net metering application than some for some procedural issue, let the state regulators, guided by the CERC, come out with a proper incentive mechanism for the DISCOM. Even if, you know, because of that...
No, 1 minute. The regulator will not come with the incentive mechanism. Its function is not to come out with an incentive. Incentive-wise has to be done by the government. Regulator has to come out with the guidelines, how to regulate a policy announced by the government.
Sir, second part.
Its purpose is different. He can't incentivize.
Incentivize in terms of, let's say, some kind of a grid connection, some kind of a stabilized of one-time fee to be paid to the DISCOM, something which incentivizes DISCOMs to quickly clear more net metering.
Incentivize has to be done by the respective state governments or the central government. It should be very clear in your mind.
Sir, second part of same question related to net metering. Even though plant is 1 megawatt,
we'll give somebody a chance.
Second part, because it is related to the same. Even though plant is 1 megawatt and multiple evacuation is there, there also DISCOM is not allowing for net metering.
I didn't get your question.
Sir, my question is related to net metering again. Even though plant capacity is 1 megawatt and DISCOM document says that up to 1 megawatt net metering is allowed, but if it is in one campus, multiple evacuation line is there within 1 megawatt capacity, that also is not allowing by DISCOM.
You have to check up. If there are multi-evacuation facility, you have to tell us. The rule is very clear from the DISCOM. My friend Mr. Manu can clarify it better. That in a, he will clarify afterwards.
Sir,
that
is ISI for modules which you have said. What about the inverters? And one more thing, what I want to ask
one minute. The BIS standard has come for every, not only modules, but for the balance of material also.
Okay. In that case, if IEC 61215 and IEC 61730 is actually basically a module certification. Now, what is more than that which BIS want to do in cert of particular? Is there any document available in MNRE website?
It must be. I have not seen it, but it has already been published. Yeah, website or not, you check up with the BIS. BIS has already issued those standards. They have been published. Where they are available, you can check up somewhere from the BIS office. My friend is there, he will address this, but I have already said we are going to have a training programs for the DISCOM officials. I just addressed, possibly you missed that point.
Great, thank you so much, sir. I think not only DISCOMs, regulators, all stakeholders need to be trained in this new revolution that, you know, clean energy is ushering in. It's a new thing for all of us. To please give his initial views, and then we can then follow it with a question answer round for him as well.
That essentially talks about the how the risks of the developers have been addressed, because very often when a lofty target is announced, say we have chosen a target of 100 gigawatt of solar for the country, unless it is broken down into specific projects, it remains just a number. So the requirement in the countries that have our projects need to be better prepared in terms of land, in terms of evacuation infrastructure. So one thing is I could perhaps have a presentation where the how the risk, various risks were covered in Rewa, that was addressed. We could have that, or as I suggested to him, that if there are some questions, we could address that, because very often there is a lack of clear understanding about, in India, electricity is in the concurrent list, so every state has its own regulations. So many of the issues that were mentioned here earlier, I would say that, there would be another viewpoint to that. For example, one friend had raised the issue of different rules being there in MP and Maharashtra and so on and so forth, and how you can have some training which can sort out the problem. Now, A, that cannot happen, because we have separate regulations for each state. Every state regulator has its own set of regulations. Then it is an accepted fact that DISCOMs are not very comfortable or not very happy with the increasing usage of rooftop solar energy. So one is operating in a slightly unfriendly atmosphere. So that is a given fact. It is also true that most regulators seem to have the interests of the conventional power sector, the DISCOMs, closer to their heart than that of solar energy. So most of the regulations are brought out to limit the scope of renewable energy or to make it more difficult to operate. So these are the ground realities that one has to live with. And it's just a question of how to work around the regulations rather than having friendly regulations. It is very often a question of how to working around those friendly regulations. So in the question answer, perhaps I can address that. So tell me, how do you want to address that?
No, I don't know. We can just have an interactive question answer session. I think so. You know, we all know about the REWA model, etc. But let me then start off, you know, the point narrative can be made for, you know, for the DISCOM in order for them to be more supportive of solar rooftop. Yes, very clearly, a paying customer is being taken away from the DISCOM. But the DISCOM still is providing the grid connection. You know, it is providing some services. It is providing integration of that service. Can there be a, either a one-time fixed cost kind of an incentive or a per month generation-based incentive that can be given to a DISCOM so that it is in their interest to also propagate? Because overall, if you look at the overall national perspective, it's economically very, very beneficial to the overall system. Right now, but yes, it, there seems to be a conflict between the DISCOM and the solar rooftop developer. So can a financial incentive be worked for the DISCOM so that it continues to pay, it continues to get paid for the wires and the services that it is providing?
Okay, first of all, let us look at this problem from the DISCOM's point of view. Because, I mean, presently I am looking after renewable energy. Last 2.5 years, I have been looking after renewable energy. But before that, I was heading the DISCOMs in Madhya Pradesh. I did for 3 years. So I also understand the problems of the DISCOMs. So let us first try to understand the problems from the DISCOMs' point of view to arrive at the answer to the question that you raised. See, most DISCOMs, many DISCOMs rather in the country, have a power excess. Now, firstly, when we use the word power excess, definitely it is a misnomer. Because as you had rightly said, that our power consumption as a country is far lower than most of the developed countries and BRICS countries as well.